So hello guys, welcome to Ankit Sunil Vets. Today I'll tell you how to take a perfect history for your respiratory system. So let's start. As usual, we will ask the name for the patient identification. We will ask the age, because like certain diseases like asthma is common in young age, COPD is common in old age, gender, because certain diseases are common in males, certain diseases are common in females, genetic disorders, and also few carcinomas. Then we will ask about the occupation. Occupation history is very, very important, because in certain occupation they will be exposed to hazardous substance. Like if a person working in a coal factory, then the person may have coal worker pneumoconiosis or some hypersensitivity. A person working in a silica may have silicosis. Working with asbestos may have asbestosis. A person working or exposure to moldy hay, then the person can have a farmer's lung. Getting exposed to sugarcane dust can have a bagosis. Then you have to ask about the chief complaint. All the chief complaint, you have to put it in a chronological order, what started first. After the chief complaint, you have to write the HOPI, which is what we call as history of presenting illness. In that, you have to elaborate all the symptoms. You have to mention the positive symptom first, and then you have to mention the negative symptom or negative history. Then in the end, you have to mention the summary. So let's start. So basically, first would be dyspnea. The definition of dyspnea is, it is a sensation of difficult breathing or uncomfortable breathing. You have to differentiate the symptoms of respiratory system and the cardiovascular. So basically, there are four cardinal symptoms of respiratory system, which is cough, chest pain, breathlessness, and hemoptysis. And there are five cardinal symptoms of cardiovascular system, which is chest pain, syncope, breathlessness, palpitation, and pedal edema. With the help of these symptoms, you can differentiate between whether the disease belongs to respiratory system or cardiovascular system. I would like to mention that there is something called cor pulmonale, in which there is a right heart failure or a right ventricular hypertrophy or enlargement due to the chronic lung disease like COPD or some pulmonary vessel disease. So there are certain diseases of respiratory system, if they are chronic, so in later stage, they can damage or can affect your cardiovascular system. So you have to make sure that you catch them in your history. So in the dyspnea, first what you have to ask is about the onset. If the onset is sudden, then you have to think about the diseases like there is a sudden pneumothorax, or there is a inhaled foreign body which is causing obstruction and causing dyspnea. It could be insidious, like slow gradual progression in case of anemia, pleural effusion, or COPD. You have to talk about the progression, and specially you have to mention with MRC class. The MRC is a Medical Research Council dyspnea scale. Starts from 0. At 0, there is no breathlessness. Only when the person does a sternness exercise, there is a dyspnea. On the grade 1, there is a breathlessness when the person is walking uphill. Grade 2 is when the person has to stop for a breath when walking at own pace. Grade 3, when the person have to stop after walking about 100 meter. Grade 4, when there is too breathlessness to leave the house, when the person is only limited to his home. So you have to use the MRC classification. Like initially 4 months back, when the person was having a MRC class 1 dyspnea, now it has progressed to class 3. So with this, the examiner can estimate, okay, it has progressed this much fast or slow. Then you have to talk about the postural variation, especially in diaphragmatic palsy, which is of two type. One could be a unilateral or a bilateral. In case of unilateral, person would be mostly asymptomatic. It won't have, the person won't have much of dyspnea. But in case of bilateral, it would be a dramatic dyspnea. As soon the person lies down, person will suddenly wake up. The person can't even lie down. Paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, in which like person will sleep for 1 or 2 hours, then afterward he will wake up to grasp some fresh air. For paroxysmal or nocturnal dyspnea, there it could be some cardiac causes, or it could be a respiratory cause also. So let's see this postural variation in detail. If the person is lying toward the normal side, if suppose the person is having a disease on left side and a normal on the right side, if person is lying toward the right side on the bed, means on the right lateral side, then what could be the cause? It is done by the patient generally to increase the perfusion, and also it prevents the spread of a disease. It is seen in case of pneumonia, bronchiectasis, or a lung abscess. If the person prefers to lie toward the affected side, it means if the person is lying toward the left lateral side, if the person is having a disease on the left, then it is done to decrease the movement of the left side. It means the left side is affected. It is done in case of pleuritis. The next thing is orthopnea. It means the person is comfortable at sitting but cannot lie down, as I previously told, in case of your bilateral diaphragm palsy. But it can also occur in case of ascites, COPD or bilateral upper lobe bulla. Then the next thing is platypnea. In this person is comfortable in lying down and not in sitting position. This is a ulta or opposite of your orthopnea. Like when the person is standing, so at the apex of the lung there is better ventilation. Ventilation is better, but at the base have generally maximum volume. Base of the lung have maximum AV fistula. In case of pulmonary AV fistula, when the person lies down, the effect of gravity dependent perfusion is eliminated in the AV fistulas of the lung. And also in case of hepatopulmonary syndrome, what happens? There is a vasodilation. So the already existing pulmonary AV fistula opens up at the base of lung, which causes dyspnea at sitting. So what are the causes of dyspnea? It could be airway causes in case of obstruction, COPD. It could be pulmonary circulation causes like pulmonary embolism, pulmonary hypertension, parenchymal causes, pneumonia, TB, fibrosis, sarcoidosis. Then next, what we can ask about the wheeze. Wheeze is a high-pitched whistling sound generally produced in expiration when the air passes through the small airways. So we have to ask about the onset, duration, progression, aggravating factor, relieving factor, associated with skin rash or dust or energy. Generally, wheeze during the exercise is seen in case of asthma or COPD. Night wakening in case of asthma, PND. Wheeze are seen after wakening in morning in case of COPD. So the next symptom that you have to ask about is the cough. Generally for the cough, what I would like to tell you is, like, you should also understand the mechanism of cough. The afferent pathway for the cough is your trigeminal nerve, your glossopharyngeal nerve, superior laryngeal nerve and vagus. The efferent for the cough is your recurrent laryngeal nerve and spinal nerve. So basically what happens in cough is, cough occurs in three phases. So the first phase is inspiratory phase, where the person engulfs approx 2.5 liter of gas or air. Then the second phase is compressive phase, where the glottis is closed. Then the third phase is expiratory. So during the expiration, the glottis is open and the air is expired as a cough. Cough is generally kind of a defensive mechanism, but cough can cause certain complications if cough is there for a prolonged duration. So why do we need to treat and why need to give importance to cough is because cough can cause pain, like your abdomen pain, chest pain, cough syncope. In this, what happens, your raised intrathoracic pressure causes impaired venous return, which decreases your cardiac output and then can cause syncope. It can cause vomiting. It can cause rupture of famatus bulla, which can also cause to your spontaneous pneumothorax. There may be hemoptysis, hernia. There may be prolapse of rectum or uterus. There could be in old age, when the bone are very fragile, then it can cause your rib fracture also. Cough generally can be divided into acute or chronic. Between 3 to 8 weeks is called as subacute. For cough, for any more than 2 weeks, we suspect of TB. Like, causes of acute cough is like upper respiratory infections, viral syndrome, allergies, or exacerbation of COPD or pneumonia. The causes of subacute are like generally post-infection or asthma. The causes of chronic cough is, as I told, TB, bronchial asthma, GRD, a smoker's cough. Then you have to ask about whether the cough is dry or productive. Generally, there are various types of cough that we will see, like dry cough. The most common cause of dry cough is gastroesophageal reflux disease, GRD. It could be due to because of certain drugs like ACE inhibitors or few ARBs. It could be there because of pleural disease or interstitial lung disease or asthma. Dry cough is without sputum and productive cough is with sputum. It could be because of TB, pneumonia. Then there's something called barking cough, which is called as painful cough, seen in case of croup, bovine cough, which is feeble and non-explosive type of cough, which is seen in recurrent laryngeal nerve. Some cough may aggravate in position, like in case of bronchiectasis. So further in cough, you have to ask about diurnal variations and also about the complications. If the person is having any complications of cough, then you need to ask that in your history. If the person says there is a cough with the expectoration, means with the sputum, then what you have to ask about that is the quantity, whether it's scanty or copious. Copious is seen in case of bronchiectasis. What is the variation? There is a diurnal variation or there is a postural variation. You have to ask about the color. Like, color can help you to diagnose a lot of causes. Like, color would be green or yellow in case of infection, especially bacterial infection. It would be black in case of pneumoconiosis, rusty in case of pneumococcal pneumonia. In certain cases of streptococcal pneumonia also, it could be a red currant jelly in case of Klebsiella, anchovy sauce colored sputum in case of amoebic liver abscess, serous cough which is seen, which would be of watery in case of bronchial carcinoma, pink and frothy sputum in case of pulmonary edema, mucoid which would be clear and grey in case of COPD, asthma will have white and viscid kind of sputum. In the cough with expectoration, you have to ask about the consistency, thick and viscous in case of bronchiectasis, pink and frothy, pulmonary edema. Is it whether it is false smelling, purulent or not? Is whether it is blood stained or not, because it could be there in case of TB, lung cancer. You have to ask about the chest pain. Differentiate between the certain causes like parenchymal causes and your pleural causes. If there is a parenchymal disease, generally it is no pain because the parenchyma is pain insensitive. And it won't have any aggravating or relieving factor. The example of parenchymal diseases are fibrosis, pneumonia, interstitial lung disease. But if the disease is of pleura, then there will be sharp stabbing or shooting kind of a pain, which will relieve on lying to the same side, because when you lie on the same side, you decrease the movement of the dead side. It may aggravate in case of cough, straining. The example of pleural disease is like pleurisy, if pleural effusion or hydrothorax. To in chest pain, you have to ask about the site, onset, duration, even the progression also, because initially there may not be a chest pain, but slowly the person may feel the chest pain because there are certain lung malignancies which are central and which are peripheral. So if the lung malignancy which started at the center of lung would have reached to the periphery or may have a mets at the ribs, then also the person may have a chest pain. Generally, the malignancies which are central are squamous cell carcinoma or your small cell carcinoma. Peripheral are your large cell carcinoma, adenocarcinoma. The adenocarcinoma is more common in females and also in non-smokers. Small cell carcinoma have a strong predisposition by smoking, so smoking is a main risk factor for small cell carcinoma. So you have to ask about the radiation of brain, progression, aggravating or relieving factor. You have to ask about whether it is associated with nausea, vomiting or sweating, because in case of myocardial infarction or a cardiac related causes, then there could be sweating and nausea. So what are the causes? As I told, pleural causes, chest wall causes, tracheal causes, great vessels like in case of aortic dissection, cardiac causes, pulmonary embolism, myocardial infarction, esophageal causes, rupture, mediastinal causes. And the next symptom that you have to ask is about the hemoptysis. Hemoptysis, you have to ask about the duration, episodes, whether it is fresh blood or coffee brown colored. When the hemoglobin is mixed with the gastric acid, the color of blood changes to coffee brown. So you have to ask about the amount or severity, because that will help us to find the severity of the, like how much blood loss has occurred and shall we plan for a blood transfusion or how soon we should start the fluid. You have to look for the association with purulent sputum or food particles. Hemoptysis may be serratia infection also. So the causes of hemoptysis, it could be croup, it could be central lung carcinoma, if it is pink and frothy in case of pulmonary edema. Bronchiectasis will have a massive hemoptysis, like more than 400 ml, because the bleeding is from the bronchial artery. In case of mitral stenosis, there could be a rupture of bronchial vein. So the bleeding is kind of mild in case of mitral stenosis compared to the bronchiectasis, which will have a massive hemoptysis. Here one additional point I would like to tell is histoplasma, which is a fungal infection which can mimic tuberculosis. Then you have to ask about the fever. Fever I have discussed in my previous video where I have discussed about the abdomen history. Fever you have to ask about the onset, duration, low grade, high grade. So with chills and rigor, is there in case of malaria or any abscess or any cholangitis, UTI. You have to ask about the history of evening rise of temperature, because this will give you a key hint for your diagnosis of tuberculosis. Why there is a evening rise in case of tuberculosis is because, like, normally also during the evening cortisol decreases and there is an increase in basal metabolic rate, like your BMR increases. In case of tuberculosis, there is some certain cytokines release which exaggerate this response and causes the evening rise of temperature in case of tuberculosis. Then you have to ask about your past history of tuberculosis or aspiration, any history of allergy, fever, whooping cough, or any tooth extraction. Like, history of dental caries is also very important, because if there is any aspiration, it can go to the lung and cause lung abscess also. You have to ask the history of diabetes or hypertension, whether the person is taking any treatment or not, history of any respiratory infections. You have to ask about the family history, like in case of cystic fibrosis, which is autosomal recessive, and you have to ask whether the person is married or not, because if there is any infertility, it could be there in case of cartilaginous syndrome, it could be there in case of cystic fibrosis, where there is a azoospermia, and in certain cases vast difference may be absent. You have to ask about history of allergy, asthma, eczema. You have to ask about the personal history. As usual, smoking is very very important. What the person used to smoke, BD, cigarette, hookah, like how much he used to smoke in per day, what age he started, because ultimately what you have to calculate is a pack years. Pack years is calculated as years of smoking into number of cigarette packets per day the person used to smoke. If the pack year is more than 20, there is more risk of COPD. If the pack year is more than 40, then there could be chances of bronchial cancer. Smoking, you must know what is the definition of a smoker or a person who is a non-smoker. Some says, like, if the person has smoked less than 100 cigarette or BD in his lifetime, he is still considered as non-smoker. You can't put a person who have just smoked once, or he have just tried as once, you can't put him on a smoker category. You have to put him in a non-smoker category only. And you have to be very very careful while taking a history of smoker and non-smoker. You have to ask the history of alcoholism, because alcoholism, when the person lose his conscious, then the person is more prone for aspiration pneumonia, which can also cause lung abscess. You have to ask the history of marked weight loss. Generally, the person himself will tell you whether he has lost a marked weight loss or not. Just to confirm it from your side, you can ask whether the rings have got loose, whichever he used to wear in his hand, or whether there is loosening of clothes. So there is marked weight loss in case of tuberculosis and any lung malignancies. In personal history, don't forget to ask about the history of pets in the home, because it can cause hypersensitivity. You have to ask about history of recent travel, like whether person have gone somewhere and he would have acquired some respiratory disease which is endemic. The bladder and bowel history may be important in case you're suspecting genitourinary tuberculosis or any other form of TB. You have to ask about any history of drug intake or allergy. Then in the end, you have to give your summary, like this person of age, or you can even mention the gender, presented with this complaint. In the history, you have to try to give whether the disease is acute or chronic, whether you are suspecting congenital or acquired, whether you are thinking of parenchymal disease or pleural disease or bronchial. If possible, then you can give your probable diagnosis also based on your history. In history, make sure to give the important positive symptom and important negative history. So with the help of history, you should narrow down your diagnosis to at least 1 to 3 disease. So recently I have updated my second editions of question banks for medicine. I am working on it. Will take some time to update the second edition. The interested person can go and buy It is there in the Kindle Amazon. The proforma for history taking of respiratory cases, I'll give the link in the description box. See you guys in the next video. Tata, bye bye.